Welcome to In Focus with Ejaz Heather. Let's get to our top story tonight. In a resolution adopted unanimously by the 47th session of the OIC in Niamey, Niger, the OIC's Council on Foreign Ministers reaffirmed its strong support for the Kashmir cause. But before we get to our discussion tonight, let me, for the viewers, state what the resolution says. In a comprehensive and strongly worded resolution, the OIC rejected the illegal and unilateral actions by India on August 5th, 2019 to change the internationally recognized disputed status of the Indian illegally occupied Jammu and Kashmir, and demanded that India rescind its illegal steps. Also demanded India to cancel the issuance of domicile certificates to non-Kashmiris and revoke all unilateral and illegal actions in IOJK since 5th August 2019, while refraining from taking any step to alter the existing demographic structure of the disputed territory. It also condemned, in the strongest possible terms, human rights violations perpetrated by Indian occupation forces and other such instances of Indian terrorism that have been the source of unspeakable suffering for the innocent Kashmiri people. It deplored the state-sponsored terrorism and crimes against humanity by Indian occupation forces against the people of IOJK, condemned extrajudicial killings during fake encounters and search and cordon operations and demolition of homes and private properties as a form of collective punishment. It denounced the renewed use of pellet guns by Indian occupation forces against innocent civilians, condemned the harassment of Kashmiri women by Indian occupation forces, deplored that India has callously exploited the current COVID-19 crisis to intensify its military crackdown and further advance its unlawful occupation in IOJK, welcomed the visit of OIC Secretary General's Special Envoy for Jammu and Kashmir to Pakistan and Azad Jammu and Kashmir from 2 to 6th March 2020, reaffirmed the sentiments expressed in the unanimously adopted communiques of the OIC contact group on Jammu and Kashmir in its ministerial meetings held on 25th September 2019 and 22nd June 2020, urged India to adhere to its international human rights obligations and allow the OIC special representative on Jammu and Kashmir and the OIC fact-finding mission to visit IOJK, strongly urged India to implement recommendations of the two reports of the UN High Commissioner for Human Rights on Jammu and Kashmir, urged international community to review their engagements with India, the occupying power, as it is violating and disregarding the international law, the international humanitarian law, and international resolutions, emphasized that the question of Kashmir is of utmost importance for the Muslim Ummah, recognized that Jammu and Kashmir is the core dispute between Pakistan and India, and its resolution indispensable for realization of the dream of peace in South Asia. Acknowledged that the people of Jammu and Kashmir are the principal party to the dispute and should be included in any peace process for resolution of the Jammu and Kashmir dispute. Affirmed that any political process slash elections held under foreign occupation cannot be a substitute to the exercise of the right of self-determination. Underscored that Jammu and Kashmir is an unresolved question of granting the right to self-determination to the people of Jammu and Kashmir that has been on the agenda of the United Nations Security Council for over 7 decades now. Reaffirmed that the fundamental right enshrined in the UNSC resolutions that the final disposition of the state of Jammu and Kashmir will be made in accordance with the will of the people expressed through the democratic method of a free and impartial plebiscite conducted under the auspices of the United Nations. So, strong words there. So, and we shall get to our discussion now. We're joined by Ambassador Tamina Janjua, former Foreign Secretary at the Ministry of Foreign Affairs, and Ambassador Asif Durrani, a former diplomat. Thank you to both my panelists. Let me begin with Ambassador Janjua here. Ambassador Janjua, very strong words. Interestingly, before the Niamey conference, there were a couple of reports that said that Kashmir was not on the agenda. So, you know, there was a sense that perhaps the government was unable to push one of the central planks of Pakistan's foreign policy. What would you say about that? And square that with the, you know, the resolution that came out.
Thank you very much. Definitely, the resolution that's been adopted by the Niamey meeting, the CFM, the Conference of Foreign Ministers, is one that we should be very pleased about, because it has not only, it's a strongly worded resolution which not only brings into focus the Jammu and Kashmir situation, but is also categorically takes positions on each and every one of the issues that have been of concern to Pakistan, and on which there has been a much debate in our media. Unfortunately, you rightly point out that there was some skepticism in the media and some reports that were appeared, which said with headlines, Kashmir not on the agenda of the CFM. I think that is irresponsible reporting. One has to be well informed and get oneself informed about reporting like this, because such reporting not only creates confusion in Pakistan, but also creates a great degree of despair in amongst the Kashmiris in Indian occupied Jammu and Kashmir itself. You may have noticed, following this press report, there was a press release that was issued by Gilani Saab, the senior leader of the APHC and the senior Kashmiri leader, who expressed great concern about this. The reality is that when you look at the agenda of the CFM, the Conference of Foreign Ministers, all issues of critical concern to Muslim countries, to Islamic countries, are all included under one major agenda item. And then these issues are taken in the plenary, in the various committees of the CFM, which is the political committee, the economic committee, the humanitarian committee. They are discussed in each one of them. And I think it is a high time that we should, our journalism should ensure that we do not pick up reports from the Indian media and flash them in Pakistan, creating despair. We have to have more responsible reporting. We have to look into what the outcome is, and the outcome, I must say, is kudos to the Ministry of Foreign Affairs, to our Foreign Secretary, who diligently worked on it, and the Foreign Minister. And obviously, there's been a great amount of work that has been done behind doors, talking to various leaders, talking to various foreign ministers, and getting into ensuring that the language that we have presented in Niger was adopted. And it's a big moment of pride for the Ministry of Foreign Affairs, I must say.
Right. Before I go further with reference to, obviously, the resolution, which is why we are here, the point that I raised and which you corroborated with reference to reporting. Now, here's the thing. You know, I've personally been saying this also, and other people have also been saying this, that given the sensitivity of many of these issues, it is perhaps important for the Ministry of Foreign Affairs to actually inform representatives of the media that report on foreign affairs and inform them of the various technicalities involved in these issues, because these conferences, the way the agendas are put together, the plenaries, the working groups, it's all very technical. And so for responsible reporting, it's important for the Ministry of Foreign Affairs to actually inform journalists how these things are worked.
I agree with you that we should have briefing sessions for journalists on how the mechanisms will work within the OIC. The agenda is adopted by, it's a rolling agenda that goes on every year. It is adopted again by the senior officials meeting, which was held a month or so ago in Jeddah. And following that, it is then it goes to the Conference of Foreign Ministers and is adopted there. Yes, we should have more briefings. I think the spokesman does go ahead and give an outline of the entire process, but yes, the details are perhaps left out. The spokesman of the Ministry of Foreign Affairs did make a statement on the very day the Foreign Minister and the Foreign Secretary left for Niamey, in which he gave the details, saying that that's not true, that it's on the agenda. And I must say that even after a clarification was issued, there are some newspapers that went ahead and gave the clarification and repeated their own story. So this is irresponsible, I must say, and this is where we have to take into account not only the sensitivities of of people in Pakistan, but of the Kashmiris who are living through hell, if I may say so, because of Indian occupation. What has come out is excellent, but what the entire process that went on, in which these reports were repeated, was not fair and not well considered. And yes, people should educate themselves. Someone should have spoken to someone in the Ministry of Foreign Affairs, or we are all available to explain how the thing goes. But it's just not fair to create the despair that was created before the conference was held.
Yes, that was very unfortunate. And, now, of course, all is well that ends well, because as we have seen, the Ministry of External Affairs of India has been really stung by this resolution, and that's very clear from their response. Ambassador Asif Durrani, there are two points in this resolution that we have recently, at the highest levels of the government, including the Prime Minister, have been making. One is that the Kashmiris are a principal party to this dispute. And secondly, the Indian state-sponsored terrorism. It seems to me that we have successfully managed to get these two important points into the resolution. Give me your reading of it.
I think you are right, and you have almost read the whole resolution, and those are the issues, I think. And I don't think that there could have been any resistance at the OIC platform not to oppose it. Reason being that there is already an OIC contact group on Kashmir. It's an exclusive group, and that has been frequenting. In fact, this year it met twice, and it made its observations quite obvious. And these points were also included in the statements of those contact groups. And then it also reiterated one important thing, is that not only the OIC, but at the UN level, the UN Human Rights Council itself is seized of the matter, and it has twice. In 2017 and 19, they have reported about the gross human rights violations, and they have asked for allow the committee to visit Indian occupied Kashmir, which India has always rejected. So the question is just not these resolutions, and then definitely Kashmiris are the principal party into that. It is a question which still is pending in the in the UN Security Council, very much. And then, if you recall recently, Indians also tried that it has been dropped from the UN Security Council agenda. This cannot be dropped, because unless the parties themselves, they decide to resolve an issue, or they want, collectively, they say that we want to withdraw the resolution. Till that time, any matter which is on the UN agenda remains on the agenda. So therefore, we should have no illusions or misunderstanding about whenever such news appears. It is definitely with a malicious agenda, with a malicious intent, and which Indians, we should not be surprised that they have been doing. So in that respect, it was very much obvious. And another, just to add what Ambassador Janjua has just said, when you talk about OIC resolutions, there's a pattern, the agenda. And agenda is that only Palestinian issue has got an exclusive agenda item. The remaining are come under other political matters, including the Kashmir dispute. So therefore, whosoever was the reporter, he tried to make an exclusive report on that, and then they wanted to insist on that. So I think it was lack of understanding. Yes, Ajaz.
Yeah, that's the problem, which is why it's important to actually pick up the phone and speak with someone. But there's another important point, Ambassador Durrani, which is about implicitly refers to sanctions against India, given India's behavior. I think that's also a very important point.
I think if you go, on about the resolution itself, then of course, definitely, it's a charge sheet against India. And this is not the first time it has. It is, in fact, a sequel to whatever has been adopted by the OIC in its previous meetings, whether it was ICFM or even in OIC summits. So on that, OIC collectively has been supporting. In fact, these commentaries came up because some of our analysts or some of our people, they wanted that our OIC member states individually should also come out and condemn India. There are, sometimes bilateral compulsions under which, some countries may not come forward. But that is understandable. For instance, on so many issues, we may support certain issues at the collective level, at the OIC level, but individually on bilateral, because of the relationship, we may not go for. So I think, but our people have tried to make an issue out of these things, and then that's why there are reports that we have now bad relations with certain Gulf states. So I think there is a need to bring in some more research, some in-depth research, and some maturity. Yes,
absolutely. Ambassador Janjua, the issue really is that these are very complex interstate relations. As Ambassador Durrani said, there's obviously bilateral relations also. There are political and economic sensitivities involved there. So we are essentially sailing through very choppy waters. And therefore, people pick up selective facts and they say, oh, we haven't really been able to do much. How do you think we can present the narrative that, no, we are actually doing a lot and doing it successfully, given the complexity of these issues?
Well, I think one of the reasons why it is said that not enough is done is because of the continuing situation in Indian occupied Jammu and Kashmir, the reality that the people of Jammu and Kashmir continue to face, and the absolute and the difficulty that they find in getting their voice being heard. Now, Pakistan has been and will continue to be a champion of the rights of the Kashmiri people, and it is, and it feels it's its responsibility to do so. The resolution that's been adopted by the OIC gives us an opportunity to, number one, tell the world that this, look, this is not just Pakistan saying it. These are 57 members of the OIC that have gone ahead and made some very strong declarations about the situation there, about the fact that the state stand, as you pointed out, state-sponsored terrorism going on in Indian-occupied Jammu and Kashmir, about the fact that there's been a complete targeting of the Kashmiris and that the Indians have paid no heed whatsoever to it. The important thing is that all of these messages that have been adopted by the OIC, CFM, and as the Ambassador Durrani said, were adopted and pronounced earlier by the contact group on Jammu and Kashmir, which was held in a virtual meeting earlier on in this year with the foreign minister chairing and the foreign ministers of all the members of the contact group participating. It is important that we should now take all these messages coming from these bodies, including the use of pellet guns, which has been strongly demonstrated in this resolution, which has been taken up as an issue by the Islamic Permanent Human Rights Commission, which and has asked for a study to be done on how this pellet gun use can be stopped, and has condemned its use. So these are things that we need to pick up from, and not only the ministries of foreign affairs of the various countries that have gone and adopted it. And may I take this opportunity to point out that the Jammu and Kashmir issue and the situation therein was highlighted not only by Pakistan, but by Turkey, by Saudi Arabia, and by Azerbaijan itself in the plenary, in the various meetings. So there are not only this one major resolution that's there, there are smaller resolutions in which references to the humanitarian situation, the economic situation, other situations are also included. And what we need to do is to now have a whole of society approach where non-governmental organizations, civil society movements, everyone should reach out to their counterparts in the OIC countries and beyond to send this message that, look, this has been adopted by the second largest organization in the world, the OIC, and therefore it needs to be taken seriously. We need to write articles on this in the international media. We need to bring it out in the international media as well. We need to sensitize the rest of the world, not the Ministry of Foreign Affairs only, but each one of us who has a certain interest, a deep interest in the situation of Indian occupied Jammu and Kashmir. We need to ensure that there may be editorials or other public articles within international media, whether it's the Spanish, the French, the US, the British, the English, the anyone of the media. So we need to take this forward like this. And as I've said it many times before, civil disobedience movements are not ones that take a little time. These are long time issues and they have to be dealt in that way. Unfortunately, the situation is terrible in Indian occupied Kashmir, and hence we have to take, and all of society, all human rights organizations, everyone involved, to go and talk about these issues and bring them to the attention of the world and get a greater supporters for the Kashmiris.
Absolutely. I couldn't have said it better. Ambassador Durrani, before I wrap up, so as Ambassador Jinjua is saying, this is something you build brick by brick. And, you know, you constantly do it. And it's not just the government's job, any and everyone interested in this. It doesn't need to be sequential. It'll be simultaneous using different fora. Now, given that, and given the fact, as I said earlier, that the Ministry of External Affairs statement clearly shows that India has been badly stung by this resolution, tell our viewers, what it actually means diplomatically and what kind of pressure builds on the state which is thus targeted by a resolution.
The foremost is that for India, they cannot defend their position about Indian occupied Jammu Kashmir. Whichever claims they may make, and they claim that Jammu and Kashmir is an integral part of India, but these resolutions actually show a mirror to the Indians that this is not the case. When it recognizes that Kashmiris are a principal party and their final fate is to be decided under a UN-supervised plebiscite, then it says all. When it says that stop killing the people, stop using pellet guns, stop arresting people, stop ghettoizing the whole bunch of an ethnic group, and stop using rape as a weapon. So this says all about whatever India wants to come. So this is building block, there's no doubt about it. Yes, India for the time being is taking advantage of its economic clout. But this is not going to happen all the time. The question
India's economy is already crumbling, and many sectors are showing negative growth. So things are not very good even at that end.
So the question is, the economy is a thing that two decades ago, Brazil and Argentina, their inflation rate was 1500% and 2000% respectively. But gradually they improved. Turkey was in bad shape two decades ago. It may be still under strain, but not anymore the situation they face. So that can always improve. But the question is, main issues concerning which have bedeviled India-Pakistan relations and which has been a nightmare for the Kashmiris, that has been collectively by the OIC, it has projected it to the world. And now I think there's a need for follow-up, and follow-up without any interruption throughout the world. And then I would rather suggest that we should also add lawfare into that, so that in the European capitals or wherever it is possible, we should take up these issues through the medium of law, and then India should be blamed and shamed for that. Yes.
Absolutely. Thank you so much. That was Ambassador Tehmina Janjua and Ambassador Asif Durrani speaking with us. We shall take a short break and return to discuss how and why an intra-Afghan agreement on the procedure for talks got stalled because of disagreement on the preamble. Stay with us. Welcome back to In Focus. Our second story tonight is about how and why an intra-Afghan agreement on the procedure for talks has got stalled because of disagreement on certain words in the preamble. According to reports, a breakthrough on an initial agreement reached between Taliban and government negotiators has been held up at the last minute after Taliban objected to the document's preamble because it mentioned the Afghan government by name. President Ashraf Ghani's spokesperson, Sadiq Siddiqui, is reported to have said that, and I'm quoting from what he said, the negotiating teams have so far agreed on all 21 articles that provide guiding principles for the negotiations. At this time, they continue to debate the preamble in which some issues need further clarification, unquote. Let's get right to our discussion. We are joined by Rahimullah Yusai, resident editor of the news in Peshawar, and Alhamdulillah Hamdard, an Afghan journalist based in Kabul. Before I get to Mr. Hamdard, the Reuters report says, and I'm quoting from the Reuters report, the government and Taliban prepared to sign the agreement. This is a diplomat in Kabul familiar with the process talking to Reuters. He added that the chief Afghan government negotiator was to sign the agreement as chief negotiator for the Islamic Republic of Afghanistan. The Taliban refused to accept that, according to this diplomat. Mr. Hamdard, is this an issue that will ultimately get resolved, or once again we are stuck for another couple of months?
I believe that if Taliban do not accept this issue or do not recognize the Islamic Republic of Afghanistan or their negotiator or the negotiating team as the representatives of the Islamic Republic of Afghanistan, then it simply would mean that Taliban are rejecting to continue the peace talks with the Afghan negotiators. If they claim that this negotiating team that has come from Afghanistan talking with them in Qatar, in Doha, Qatar, it is representing the Afghans in broadly, then I guess it does not make a lot of sense, because Taliban are not fighting the people. They are not fighting the public. They are fighting against the government. Before, they were fighting against the foreign troops plus the government, and now they are fighting only against the government, against the Islamic Republic of Afghanistan. So they don't need to talk with the Afghan people about the peace, or they don't need to negotiate the peace with the Afghan people. Because people are living under both the Islamic Republic of Afghanistan and under the Taliban, in those areas where Taliban are governing on them. So I guess it is more logical for Taliban to accept the Islamic Republic of Afghanistan at the moment and proceed with the peace negotiations. And the Afghan government may also continue to talk with the Taliban. If one of them, Taliban or the government, create problems at this stage of the negotiation, I guess this peace negotiation will fail once again.
Okay, that's an interesting viewpoint. Let me get Rahimullah Yousafzai's perspective also on this. Mr. Yousafzai, my own sense is that because the Taliban do not agree the legitimacy of Ghani's government and election, they are probably indicating that while 21 articles have been agreed on and we can talk at this stage, since we do not accept the legitimacy of the government negotiators cannot use the name Islamic Republic of Afghanistan. So Mr. Hamdard feels that if the Taliban do not accept that, then negotiations will fail. Then that means they're not particularly interested in talks. What is your take on this?
Now, this is an old position of Taliban. They say that this Ashraf Ghani government, or before that the Hamid Karzai government, is not legitimate. And that's why they were refusing to negotiate with it. They insisted on negotiating with the Americans. But I thought that, you know, they had maybe conditionally agreed to negotiate with the Afghan government. Afghan government is part of the negotiating team which came from Kabul. There are also other people who are in the opposition to the Ashraf Ghani government. So this is a joint delegation which has come from Kabul. It is an anti-Taliban delegation. I think the Taliban were saying that we will talk to every Afghan, all Afghans, but we will not, you know, differentiate between the government and the opposition. So they still have this position. But I think that, you know, this kind of, you know, issues should not be a hurdle to taking forward the process. Also, maybe the issue can be resolved. I don't know if that is possible. That, okay, they signed the agreement with the Islamic Republic of Afghanistan, and the Afghan government says, okay, we signed the agreement with the Islamic Emirate of Afghanistan, which is what the Taliban call themselves. Or they can find a way out, like the Americans did in the Doha agreement, by saying, okay, they are negotiating with the Islamic Emirate of Afghanistan, which we don't accept, which are Taliban. So I think a way out could be found. I don't think that this issue will lead to the failure of talks.
Right. These are very interesting points. Mr. Hamdard, Mr. Yousafzai has talked about how this issue was resolved when talks were happening between the Taliban and the Americans. And he believes that the same device can be used to kickstart the talks here also.
I believe that talking of Taliban with the Americans was a bit different. And Americans kind of forced Taliban to accept that they are not representing the Islamic Emirate, but the Taliban movement. And Taliban have accepted that one. Now that the Taliban are representing their political movement, not Emirate, they are talking with the Islamic Republic of Afghanistan's negotiating team. At the beginning, they were claiming that we do not recognize the Islamic Republic of Afghanistan or the government, and we do not accept representatives of the Afghan government to talk with us, and they did that. They did not accept, of course. But now, as the Americans meddled or they mediated this Afghan peace talks, and finally the intra-Afghan peace talks have started, the Islamic Republic of Afghanistan has introduced their negotiating team. Here, I guess, rejecting this at the moment, this will not be resolving the problems. It will get resolved if Taliban show some flexibility here. Of course, they can put their conditions on the peace negotiating table. Whatever they want to say during the peace negotiation, they can put that on the table. If the Afghan, the Islamic government, the Islamic Republic of Afghanistan negotiating team accept that with the Taliban, they can proceed with each other. And whatever Yousafzai say pointed out, that Taliban will also claim that they want to mention the Islamic Emirate of Afghanistan, and the Afghan government will write Islamic Republic of Afghanistan. I guess this will be very much difficult for both teams to agree upon, because there could be only one government and one fighting movement or group or fighters. They are going to talk with the government, and the Afghan government is representing the people of Afghanistan. If Taliban are claiming one thing more, that they want to talk with all Afghans, it is impossible. Why? If the Islamic Republic of Afghanistan claimed the same thing, and they say that Ashraf Ghani say, for example, President Ashraf Ghani say that I want to talk with all the Taliban separately, not only with those 21 or 25 people in Doha or Qatar, then I guess this is impossible. Islamic Republic of Afghanistan is representing the people of Afghanistan, and Taliban, who are fighting against the government, they are representing their political movement. So now, I guess it's the time to accept that, to accept the Islamic Republic of Afghanistan, and to show their willingness towards the peace building process and go ahead with these negotiating teams.
Right. Yousaf Zayi, you heard Mr. Hamdullah Hamdard. So he's making some interesting points. But it seems to me, even from Sadiq Siddiqui's statement, that the government in Kabul does not think that this is an intractable issue. And from his statement, the words that I quoted in my opening, it seems that they're hoping that this will get resolved.
You know, Yousaf, they have come this far after almost 2.5 months. And having agreed on the main issues, which are the rules of procedures, 21 points, that was not easy. So if they have achieved that, I think the preamble should not cause many problems. There is a problem right now. But I think there are mediators. You know, Qatar as the host country has a copy of the agreement. You know, the Americans are trying to mediate. Pakistanis have been asked to mediate. I think the issue will get resolved. I don't think they will pull out at this stage. You know, the preamble can be, say, altered. It can be improved. I know this is a question of legitimacy. The Afghan government says that the UN Security Council has recognized their government as the legitimate government. All the countries of the world recognize the Afghan government as a legitimate government. Taliban is seen as an armed group, which is still fighting. So we have these issues. I know that. But I think that, you know, I'm not saying, as Mr. Hamdar inferred, as he pointed out, that Taliban are saying we will talk to all Afghans. You know, there will be people who will represent all these Afghans. So the majority are representing the Afghan government. But there are others who are in opposition to the Afghan government. There are 20 people, I believe, from Kabul. So they are representing the Afghan people who are opposed to Taliban. I'm not saying every Afghan, 3 crore or 70 lakhs will come and they will sit with Taliban and all Taliban will come and talk. That's not the issue. So I think that, you know, a way out, I believe, will be found, because they don't want to fail now that after having achieved that much. I think that, there will be a solution, and I think the mediators will play a role. Taliban, will have to show flexibility. Also, the Afghan government will have to show flexibility.
Right. Let's see how this pans out, because it's not going away anytime soon. So I'm sure I'll have Rehmullah Saab and Hamdard Saab again on my program. But for now, for tonight, thank you to Hamdullah Hamdard. Thank you to Rehmullah Yousaf Zayi for speaking with us. This is all from In Focus this week. We shall see you next Monday at the same time. Keep following our latest updates on social media at indus.news. Good night and goodbye.